Okay, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are, viewers, and welcome to this edition of Viewpoint with Kenneth Oguzie. My name is Ken Oguzie, and I'm here, Nova Scotia, eastern part of Canada. As usual, today I have with me a very special guest, someone who is an inspiration to the African continent, someone who has really made a lot of accomplishments in, you know, his chosen field and his chosen career and his business enterprise as well. So I'm really delighted, and I'm really looking forward to the conversations which I will be having with this gentleman. He goes by the name Dr. Babajide Macaulay. So Dr. Babajide Macaulay is a lecturer at the Federal University of Technology, Akure, which is in Lagos, Nigeria, which is in the western part of Africa. That's within the biology field. And he also doubles as, he's a 2012-2015 Commonwealth Scholar, an RLCS 150 Fellow, and of course, a Carrington Fellow as well. So this individual has won a lot of awards and, you know, has been a huge contributor both to the African continent. And of course, as a former member of the diaspora, he's also done a lot in terms of, promoting the continent and, of course, helping to find ways to accelerate growth in the region. But without much more waste of time, I would like to invite Dr. Babajide Macaulay. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Macaulay.
Thank you very much for having me, Ken. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's good to have you. How are things that way?
Yeah, very good. We thank God. I'm in Nigeria, Africa, West Africa, yeah. And things are great. Yeah, we thank God. Yeah.
Yes, that's good to hear. So right now in Nova Scotia, we just started another 2 weeks lockdown. What is the situation? Is it the same? Are you guys, I don't think there's lockdown right now in the region.
There is no lockdown here. Pretty much everyone is just going about their business normally.
Okay.
There's no lockdown. I think all of that was last year. And ever since it's been lifted, we've tried to manage with the COVID. We just have to go on with it. And the good news, we do not have a lot of fatal cases here. So as a result, we don't have that scare.
Yeah.
Anyway, people just go about. Although when you get to some official events, they will tell you to follow the COVID-19 protocol. You wear your face mask or your nose mask. You wash your hands. Mm-hmm. You wipe your hands clean with a hand sanitizer. So you do the normal thing. Then you distance yourself from others. You don't hug. You don't shake. You still, chop the knuckle.
Yeah, the knuckles. Yes. All the elbow thing.
So we still do that. It depends on the event. But pretty much everyone they go about their normal lives. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. All right. So we'll probably just jump into the meat at this point, and because I'm sure our viewers would really want to know more about you and, listen to your story like we do here. I know you also double as the CEO of Illumania, which we'll talk about as well. But, who is Dr. Macaulay? Tell us a little bit about, yourself, your story, really.
Okay, so Dr. Macaulay is first a young Nigerian guy from Lagos, West Africa, Nigeria. And he's an academic in the Federal University in Nigeria.
Okay.
And he's also an educational consultant. So that means I have two sides of me. So let me start with the first side. So the first side of me, I graduated from a university in the southwestern part of Nigeria called Federal University of Technology, Akure, FUTA. Okay. I studied biology. I graduated in 2010. So afterwards, I was flung to Kebbi State, Nigeria, which is northwestern part of Nigeria up north, where I had my mandatory youth service, the way we do in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. So you serve your country for a year. I was posted to a government secondary school in Kebbi, somewhere called Bunza, where I taught biology for 1 year.
Okay.
So, and afterwards, in 2012, I returned to Lagos And then 2 weeks after my return, I just received a phone call from my HOD, who suddenly said, "Did you not hear that FUTA is retaining their best?" And I said, "Well, I'm not aware, sir. Come and take your job." And that's it.
You had an interview, just, you know, like your...
No interview. Fact that you had the best. There was no interview. I got FUTA and I just wrote the letter that I am thankful for the opportunity. I'm accepting the offer.
Acceptance. Well, so you qualified based on the fact that you are the best student, like graduating student from...
Yeah, I was. Yes, okay. I was. Yes.
Fantastic.
So I was the best in my cohort. Okay. I was fortunate to make a first pass. Okay. And so after I took the FUTA job, I knew that I didn't want to have any further education in Nigeria because I wanted better learning atmosphere. I wanted world-class facilities. I wanted to be taught by academic experts, you know, global academic experts. And apart from that, the area of specialization I was interested in wasn't even offered in my school. So there was the necessity to leave, but I didn't want to go to another school. I wanted to go to another country. Yeah. So I started applying for scholarships. And at the end of the day, I got the Commonwealth Scholarship, shared scholarship in 2012 for a master's degree in environmental management, sustainable environmental management at the University of Greenwich in London.
Okay.
Yes. And then I did that for 1 year from 2012 to 2013. I made a distinction. I was also the best in my cohort. I got an award for best project of the year.
Okay.
And afterwards, I returned to my university where I was promoted from the position of a graduate assistant to that of an assistant lecturer. And this gave me the opportunity to now lecture. I was now able to teach. I was also able to supervise some undergrads. And so I did this for 2 years before I then won the Commonwealth PhD scholarship for my PhD as well at the University of Manchester. My PhD is in environmental geochemistry and geomicrobiology. It's not as complicated as it sounds. It's just the study of arsenic. You know, arsenic is a poison.
Yes.
So because it's a chemical found at depth, so that's geochemistry.
Yes.
And then microorganisms are responsible for the mobility of the chemical into drinking aquifers. So that's geomicrobiology. So that's just where the coinage of the names came from. But it's nothing very complicated. It's just a fanciful name to scare people off, say, "I beg, I discovered something we don't understand." Yes. You know, that kind of vibe. Yes. So, exactly. And so in 2019, I graduated and I returned as well to my alma mater where I'm still teaching till date. So, that's the summary of my academic side. And then the summary of my consulting and the business side of me.
Yes, I was gonna actually ask that one, you know, around the shift but what's the motivation? Because I know you do the educational consulting piece. So what's the story behind that?
Okay, so the motivation was it was accidental, basically. Okay. I never planned for this, it happened by chance. So what happened was when I won the scholarship in 2012, I started getting a lot of buzz from people who would say, "Oh, sorry, I just read about you. You won the Commonwealth. Can you help me out? I also want to win this." So I became an automatic mentor to a lot of strangers.
Yeah.
And so they were reaching out and I was also helping out. And that was how it started. Mm-hmm. So I started helping out from 2012. I'll help out with instructions, advice, step-by-step procedures, sometimes as deep as even editing their personal statements or application forms. So I was going that far. And as little as sometimes I even write reference letters for some people. If I know you well, I'll write you a reference letter. Since I'm an academic in the university, the advantage of that is that I have a letterhead with the name of the school, and I can authoritatively write on that.
Yes. So you know the person and you can testify.
Yes.
Proficient.
So so that was how it started, and I was doing this for free until 2018. So that's after 6 years. Then I had a couple of friends. I think we hung out in Spain to celebrate me. And what really happened was I assisted the six of them with their dissertations. They were doing masters in Manchester while I was doing my PhD at the time. So they were having a challenge with their dissertation, and then they reached out to me, knowing well that I had a distinction on my master's dissertation too. So they felt I would know something to help them out. And indeed, I was able to help them. Despite the fact that they were in different disciplines, I was still able to help them out. And they all had distinctions, except for one who had a merit. So it was five distinctions and a merit, six of them. And to say thank you and to celebrate me, you know what these guys did? They planned for the summer break to be in Barcelona, and it was going to be in my birthday week.
Okay, so it was.
So when we got to Barcelona, they took me to Opium. It's a high class restaurant stroke bar in Barcelona, and that's where I marked my birthday officially. Mm-hmm. I looked like a decent guy and a responsible guy in my tuxedo suit or something. Yeah. And then they all started giving speeches about me. Oh, he's a great guy. He's this, he's that. And suddenly they just turned around and said, do you know what? I think you have a gift. I think there's something about you, the way you handle this educational thingy. I think it's beyond just a career thing. I think it's more about, it's your destiny. Like, and if you touch it, it's gold. Because everyone you keep assisting, they keep getting good news. Whether I help you with your dissertation or I help you with a scholarship form, you will just do well. And so they were like, you need to monetize this because there's a market here. Yeah. And that was the first time it dawned on me that I could actually turn this into a business. And so when we got back to Manchester, that was the first thing I thought about. The company name. And it took me 48 hours to come up with the name. And it took me about a month to design the website because I had to get someone who would do that Lagos. And then by 1st January 2018, Illumenia was born. And the rest, they say, is history.
It's history. So how has the journey been for Illumenia in terms of, you know, so at present, what sort of services does your company offer?
Okay, so it's basically an educational consulting firm. So we provide academic support to students, graduates, and business professionals. So the kind of services we render first is dissertation, just as I said. So we do dissertation review. We are not going to write it for you. We will review your draft because we believe that it's unethical, it's unprofessional to do so. So once you have your draft, then we review to make sure that it's distinction worthy. Then we also help you with your CV for people who just finished from school and do not actually know how to prepare their CV to be catchy. You can reach out to us. We'll ask you what sector you are interested in because we are aware that a CV sometimes is sector specific.
Of course.
It could also be geographical specific, the country where you are. It could be continentally specific as well. And as well, even discipline specific. So we ask a number of questions before we start touching your CV or trying to adjust it. We also help out with personal statement review. So if you're applying for a job or a scholarship and they ask you to write an SOP, a statement of purpose, or a letter of motivation of 500 words or more, you can bring it to us at a cost, a very small affordable fee, and we do it. Then we also help with scholarship application length. That's the entire scholarship in case you have multiple essays. A good example is Commonwealth that has got 11 essays, or Chevron that has got 5 essays, or MasterCard that has got 5 essays. Those kind of scholarships that with multiple essays, you can bring them to us and we sort out everything. But we are not going to write
those for you. So you mean you need to write 5 different essays to assess those scholarships like along the way? Is that what you mean?
Yes, yes, 5 different essays. That's... And the Commonwealth is even the most technical one I've ever seen. Because that one, you have to write 11 essays.
Wow.
Yes. And so, but we do not write it from scratch. We won't write it for you. So you need to have a draft. It is fine if the draft is not perfect. That's why you are paying us.
Yeah.
So it is fine. We just want to have an idea of who you are, where you see yourself in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time, why you are studying what you want to study, or why you chose what you want to study. So it will help us know how to put your best foot forward. But if we have nothing, we can't think from air. So we need to see something, and that's why you need to submit a draft. We need to see your draft before we work. So we do all of this, including data analysis. If you need to process data and you don't know how to go about it, we have data experts on our team who will do that and advise you on even the right one to use for the nature of data you have, or for the kind of outcome you expect. So these are the kind, and research proposal writing, business proposal writing, all this, about nine of them that we offer.
That's quite comprehensive. And I think for me, like, it's really good what you're doing, because it's not just, there's still some, you know, altruistic motive in there. So it's not just so much around, I have a business, you know, it's all about impact. You know, we do have a lot of people from the continent who want to go study, you know, abroad, and who pretty much sometimes need some of this help, because of there's a lot of catching up to do. And for someone like you who has navigated the system, you carry a lot of experience with you, and the fact that you've created a platform where people can access it and really get that expert advice, it's priceless. But I wanted to, so you've won the 2012-2015 Commonwealth Award. Talk us through that. What was that like for you? Like, and what's this Commonwealth Award really? What's it all about? For those who don't know about it.
Okay, so first of all, the Commonwealth Scholarship is a scholarship offered by the British government.
Okay.
It's one of two scholarships sponsored by the British government. Okay. The second one is Chevening.
Chevening, yes. I know.
Yes, that. So, but the two of them are different because of the focus. Are different. So for Commonwealth, it started first in 1959. Okay. That was when the Commonwealth was officially established. And it's to target Commonwealth countries. Okay. These are countries that were once colonized by the British Empire. Imperialist government of the British Empire, I would say. So they were the first. So it was more like to give back. Okay, since we have taken so much from these people, what can we do to give back? Okay, let's take some of their best brains, train them, and return them. Hopefully, they will be able to build their country. That's just the idea around the Commonwealth and the Chevening, which is the reason why they will always ask you to return. Because what they are doing technically is to build you human capital development for national growth in your home country. So that's why they will always ask you to sign a document to return. So the Commonwealth was established in 1959, and it was focused on the brilliant ones. So you're doing so well, great grades. Your grades are topping the charts. You are top 5% in your cohort. You are likely to win the Commonwealth. Then in 1983, they realized that, wait a minute, we have left out another amazing group of people. These are people that may not have excellent grades, but they are doing so well in their society.
Leadership.
So in my, sorry?
I said leadership and all of these pieces.
Exactly, leadership, community development, service, and all of that. And so they decided to start Chevening in 1983. And the Chevening targets potential leaders, influencers. That's why when you look at the nature of those who have won it, you see these are people that have done something. There's evidence to show they have been helping their society, no matter how small. Because during the interview, even if you survive the application phase, they will fish you out during the interview and know that you are not who you claim you are. Because you need to prove your worth during the interview. Explaining exactly what you have done, and showing the impact. And that's how they would know whether you deserve the Chevening or not. So there are two different scholarship types. But I went for the Commonwealth because that suits me. I was the best from my class. And I had just graduated. I didn't have work experience. I had just gotten employment with my school. I had spent about 6 months with them. So the Commonwealth was fantastic. It was a perfect bet for me. And that's why I applied. But at the same time, even with the first class, you might still not be selected if your essays are bad. You know, I told you that there are 11 of them. Mm-hmm. Now, I had no mentor. I had no one because at the time I graduated in 2010, when I went on the internet and I see people who have gone ahead of me and are in the UK or in US, and you write them, they will read your message and not respond.
Yeah.
So I was like, what is going on? So I was left alone. I had to get it on my own. So I made a lot of errors. And during my master's application phase in 2011, 2012, I applied to 25 universities. 25.
Wow, 25. Yes. Wow.
Yes, and I lost 23 of them.
Wow.
It was the very last two that I won. The very last two.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and one of them happened to be the Commonwealth, and I decided to pick that.
Mm-hmm.
The other was the London Metropolitan University Scholarship. I decided not to pick that because it only covers my school fees. The tuition, I still need to pay for the living cost. And that will still run into millions that I do not have.
Yeah.
So it was obvious for that I needed to go for the one that will cater for everything. The Commonwealth caters for everything. It's one of the best scholarships to ever win in your life.
Yeah.
Because you would even not pay for visa.
Yeah.
Let me tell you how funny it is. The medical test that you are going to do before you apply for your visa, you will still be paid for it, like you will be refunded.
Yeah.
So it's like you're not paying a penny at all. So it's a fantastic scholarship, but extremely competitive.
Competitive. Fair.
And I was so blessed to win it twice. So I won it in 2012 for my master's. And then in 2015, I tried it again. And I won it for my PhD. Now, for the PhD in 2015, the approach is quite different.
Mm-hmm.
Because for PhD, you either need to be nominated by your government in your country through the Ministry of Education, or you are nominated by some other NGOs. There is a list of them. I think there are about three of them. And you must be members of the NGOs before they can even nominate you.
Wow.
And lastly, is if you are an academic staff, then your university can nominate you. If only your university is on their list, on the Commonwealth list, because the Commonwealth has a list of universities that can nominate. Okay. I think in Nigeria, there are about 21 of them or so, 21 or 25.
Okay.
It's not the entire school in Nigeria, it's 21 or 25. And I was lucky that my school, FUTA, was on the list, and so they nominated me. I was the sole nominee in 2015, and I later got the award. So I'm thankful to my school as well. Yeah. I guess I returned as a way to say thank you.
Thank you, and you're still doing it.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they appreciate, like, it's always
great. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I see it every day.
It's always great to see that, like, you going out there and getting all of this knowledge and all these pieces, and then you bring it back, you give them back to both the university and the society as a whole. So, you know, kudos to, you know, people like yourself. And I mean, I think it's great too, because the fact that you've had that dual perspective, living in diaspora and someone who understands, you know, what's on ground, if I use that word, in your local community. So it's perfect. Like you always bring up this amazing idea. But I'm sure you did face some challenges, like going through all of these things. Like, what has been the mindset for you in terms of these challenges and overcoming these challenges?
Okay, so I did face, and I had to overcome. Now, for the academic side of me,
mm-hmm.
The challenge was that I needed to get my master's and PhD on time, especially my master's. Now, when I got the offer from my school, it was a graduate assistantship position, which was to last for 2 years.
Okay.
After which I will be sacked if I do not get my master's.
Your master's, okay.
Let me say that again.
Yeah.
It's a graduate assistantship position
for
2 years.
Yes.
After which I will be sacked if I do not have my master's degree.
Yes.
So there was a lot of pressure on me.
Of course.
To get my master's. And at some point, when the scholarships, when I began to lose them, I had to start thinking of a last resort, because I had lost so many scholarships that, and time was going by, you know, I was like, I don't have time and I'm losing all these scholarships and I don't want to be sacked. Yes. So do you know what I did? I took up a form from the University of Ibadan.
Okay.
In Southwest Nigeria, our best school here. Okay. I always say it's our best school here anyway. Hmm. I had to pick up a master's form from Ibadan. And as the last resort, in case anything goes wrong.
Yeah, like a backup.
And I'm glad I didn't have to use it. I'm glad I didn't have to. But I took up the form, I paid for it, and I did everything I needed to do. But I eventually abandoned it. So it was one of the challenges I faced, because I was scared that eventually, if things go bad, I needed to have a plan B.
Yeah.
So that was one. And everyone should have a plan B, just in case.
It is.
And so that was one. Secondly, the other challenge I faced was when I got to the UK, cool, different ballgame entirely. I discovered that the learning environment, the method of assessment is different from where I was coming from. There was a lot of essay writing, essay coursework.
Yes.
Write 3,000 words, 2,000 words, blah, 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 blah. Things I weren't used to when I was in Nigeria. In Nigeria, it's basically examination, test, examination. Yes. But over there, there were lots of essay writing.
Writing.
And my flaws just came out, poof, into thin air. So I was scoring 58%.
Yeah.
Me, I was a straight A student where I came from. Straight A. I couldn't believe it. Like, I was wondering what I did wrong. But I struggled through it. But I survived because I asked for help. That's another thing.
Yeah.
Always ask for help.
Mm-hmm.
The moment you realize something is wrong, don't sit there and just watch. Because if you do that, nothing is going to change. You have not changed your methods.
Absolutely.
And if you don't change your methods, the outcome will remain the same.
Mm-hmm.
So I needed to scream out loud for help. And eventually they told me that the Drill Hall Library in the University of Greenwich has got a writing team that can support you.
Yes.
So I went there. I went there for, I think, three sessions. I had three sessions with them. And they corrected me that, look, you can't write this way.
Mm-hmm.
Because in academics, we don't show emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So words like sadly, unfortunately, you can't use all those expressions. And I use them a lot.
Yeah.
So they had to tell me to stop them. You know, we speak straight to what the fact is.
Yes.
We don't have time to weigh the emotion. Like, sadly, the man died. You just tell us that the man died, and he died of so thing. 300 people died, or two out of every five people died of COVID-19 a year. Period. There's nothing like, unfortunately, they had to die, you know? So I needed to change all of that and learn academic writing. And before I knew what was happening, my writing changed and I got a distinction mark in my project. I got the highest mark too. And that's how I got the best project of the year. It's amazing because the same me who was having 52, it eventually topped the department and even graduated with a distinction.
Yes.
Yeah. So, that's the challenge and how I was able to go about it for the academic side.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for my entrepreneurship side, my business side, the first challenge I experienced was basically distrust, public distrust.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because I run an online consulting firm where everything is online, I was getting phone calls with people saying, is this Illumina? I'll say yes. And they were like, where is your office? I'll say, we don't have an office. It's online. And they're like, okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
And that's the end of it.
Yeah.
They were like, these guys have not got a physical office. That means they can run away with my money.
Of course. Of course.
And so there was this distrust. Like, I didn't experience it with clients from the UK. I experienced it with clients from Nigeria.
Yeah,
and I think they were just skeptical. And I understand why. To tell you the truth, I think I understand why.
Mm-hmm.
So I struggled to like change the orientation of my clients, tell them we are for real, we are registered, it's a legal firm, it's legally known. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't working. Mm-hmm. Until 2019, when the British Council invited me to give a talk on the Commonwealth Scholarship. And after it, they made this graphic work with my face on it, saying, thank you for speaking at the UK Study Fair, I think the 2019 one.
Okay.
That image, I made a screenshot of it and I placed it on my social media platforms. And bingo, boom, that was all I needed.
Everything.
They just started calling me.
Credibility just came in from nowhere, right? That's how it works, right?
I'm telling you. And so I feel like all you need is for a credible organization to recognize what you do.
Absolutely.
And trust me, that will be the beginning of your elevation. Absolutely. All you need is for a credible organization to say, we know this guy, we know he's credible, we know he's doing well. Reach out to him if you need help for anything. That's all.
Yeah.
And your life will not remain the same. And that was everything I needed. And to date, we don't even beg anyone anymore. Like, people beg us now. It's now the other way around.
Yeah.
Like, please, can you work on this stuff? I need it in 2 days. I need it in 5 days. And it's amazing how far mm-hmm. we've come.
Mm-hmm.
And so the social capital grew because a credible organization like the British Council invited me.
Yes,
and so that solved automatically most of the problems we had.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. And I think there are a lot of lessons learned there. You know, I think sometimes we just need to focus and keep doing what we're doing. And people are watching, people are, you know, keeping track. And those credible organizations are also keeping track. It's just a question of time for them to, you know what, we'll reach out to this person and whatever it is, however they want to engage you, that then sort of opens up the doors, you know, for other people and all of that. So I think that's an amazing story. And hopefully our viewers can actually understand the principles behind what you achieve and the mindset, you know, that really sets you apart from, you know, the rest of other people. But I think, so if you were to, as an entrepreneur who's, you know, gone through all of this whole, I use the word roller coasters, up and downs, you know, you've had the downtime, uptime, and, you know, but right now, I think you're more of like on the rise and, you know, there'll probably be more to come from your organization. So what would your, if you were to give two advice to young entrepreneurs who are looking to, you know, set up a business, what would those be?
Okay, so advice number one would be, money should not be your first concern.
Wow.
Partnership, network should be your first concern.
Nice.
Because the time I set up my organization, I can tell you for a fact that I was just an academic. I didn't know anything about finance.
Yeah.
Even till now, I still struggle with business plan.
Yeah.
I'm not a financial person. I'm an environmental scientist, full stop. But when it started coming to the figures, you know, finance and all of that, I needed someone. And my friend and partner in my business, who I had to speak to, works for the Big Four in London.
Yeah.
This guy is a top-notch guy. But I met him in Manchester, sold my idea to him, and he was in full time.
Yeah.
And this is the guy that goes to the back end and sorts out the finance of my business for free. I don't even pay him. He doesn't even want to collect my money.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, he does it for free. He's just excited to help me.
Yeah.
You know, and this is a top-notch guy. I told you he works for the Big Four in London and he's the face behind the finance, managing my business at the back end. So, and some other people like that I was able to get, and I don't pay them.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm to pay them, I would probably not be able to afford to. So you can see that money is usually not the first thing, but who is in your network? Who are your partners? Who can you speak to that will buy your idea? If you can't convince one soul about your business, then trust me, that business is not good. That business has no future. You can't convince one soul to buy into it, then trust me, just forget about it and do something else.
I know.
And so in my honest opinion, first thing first, it's not money. The partners that you have and your network, reach out to them and let them key in. You will see that you won't be worried so much about capital. You know the way people talk about capital. Yeah. You'll be so worried about that eventually, because a lot of these people will offer you their services for free, and it will take out almost 70% of the capital you have needed. Now, second advice is stay calm. In business, you have to stay calm. There is always a teething period for every business.
I agree.
Mine was my first year. You know, I invested close to 500,000 naira into the business. And in my first year, I made 50,000 naira. No joke.
Typical.
50,000 naira.
That's what
That's happened. A lot. You know, but I didn't stop. I kept going. And at some point in the business, by the third year, I was making over a million. And I started off with 50,000 naira. What if I had given up? And a lot of people give up so early. So stay calm. If you feel it's time to take stock on whether to give up or not, at least stay 3 years. Let your third year be the decision year. If you are still making losses first year, second year, third year, then you can probably make some strategic decisions about the direction of your business. But it is too early after the first year or your second year to panic. Just stay calm. It's normal. That's my second advice. And I'll put jara, as we used to say in Nigeria, jara, I'll put extra. And the extra is innovate. Always innovate. The moment your business starts doing well, don't sit down there and think you are God or you are king. Always innovate. Why I'm saying that is that in 2020, when Uncle Corona decided to strike, it affected a lot of businesses. But what happened? We innovated. We started doing virtual classes. This is a service we were not running at all prior to 2020. But the moment we discover that people are at home, they will likely be stuck to their phones, their screens. Let's do a virtual class. We made millions of naira. No joke. I said I was not going to say it, but I don't know how I'm saying this money now. Before they would say that I've made all the money in the world. I've not made any money. You can see my shirt is still very cheap. I still never make any money. I'm still I'm still trying to get up.
Anyway.
But the point I'm making, the point I'm making is, we were able to innovate. We saw opportunity. We saw new opportunities, and we started doing new services. We offered new services that we were not offering, and it made us make more money. And we made more money that year, a year that was a distress year. It was a distress year for lots of organizations, but we doubled our profits. So innovate. Innovate, and at the moment we are planning something, but I can't tell it right now. We are planning something that is going to blow everyone's mind the moment we are done. It has actually been created, but we are testing it because we want to know the loopholes in there, sort everything out before we go public. So, but by the time it comes out, boom, trust me, it will probably triple our profits. But we are working on something. So constantly think of ways to innovate, improve, do things, expand your portfolio. Always think about your environment, your people, your clients. What are their needs? Like this new thing we are working on, it was created from the behavior of our clients. We noticed over 3 years of running our company that there's a certain behavior and a certain question they continue to ask.
Absolutely.
And so we created a solution for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So always take note of all these tips to know how to innovate in your mm-hmm. business. Mm-hmm. So that's my final.
I mean, those are valuable advice, you know, innovation, you know, staying focused, not letting access to finance be a barrier for you, you know,
yeah.
A bit more introspection, look around your network, what are some of the free services you can access, you know, and of course, be patient, trust the process.
Exactly.
So basically, if you're so passionate about something and you've done your homework, it is natural for it to experience setbacks within the first, second year. That's why it becomes sustainable. You have to go through that
process.
So I think it's something we preach about, and it's really great to hear it from yourself, like someone who is doing it, like you are doing it. This is not academic. This is not a research. This is something you are living every day, you know, so it's great.
Exactly.
It's great. And, you know, as we round off with the chat, you mentioned something, and I'll probably give you 2 minutes to do this so that we can let you go, because I know it's Saturday evening and, you know, I don't want to take all your time. You mentioned the part around online education, which, you know, based on what COVID is, and we talk about the new normal, and I say to people, like, your new normal, yes, but the world will never be the same again. That one is for sure. And some of the myth have been broken, some of those biases people have over virtual, that it cannot be replicated. We need this classroom, all of these pieces. What would you say, what's the future like for like online, you know, education asset, like accessing online education materials and delivery and programs? So maybe in 2 minutes, what would you say is what's your prediction or outlook for Nigeria and Africa? Let me put it that way.
Okay, now the thing is, it's sad that we often play catch up.
Mm-hmm.
The developing countries often play catch up.
Mm-hmm.
Online learning has been on for years in the developed countries. True. So the moment COVID struck, it wasn't a problem at mm-hmm. all.
Mm-hmm.
They just stuck onto their infrastructure that they already had.
Mm-hmm.
And life continued. And if you notice, learning didn't stop in those parts of the world, mm-hmm. but learning stopped in our part of the world because we were not prepared. We didn't have the infrastructure for that to take off.
Mm-hmm.
Infrastructure like what exactly? Like proper internet that works. Mm-hmm. Proper internet that works.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Two, power. You need power. Can I tell you that this power you are seeing now, it's my power. I was the one. The power from the national grid is unavailable. This is power that I created, sadly, by burning fossil fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And I am an environmental scientist, but you leave me with no choice. That is the cheapest source I have. So you leave me with no choice, but mm-hmm. I had to provide my own power for this to happen.
Mm-hmm.
So power is number two. And number three is also the learning platform. What learning platform are you going to use to carry out your online teaching and learning?
Mm-hmm.
So that's another thing. So all of this we're missing in the developing countries, including Nigeria.
Yeah.
But the moment COVID struck and the federal government, through the NUC, that's the National Universities Commission, the moment they now told universities across the country
mm-hmm.
that you guys cannot continue learning as usual. You have to do it virtually.
Uh-huh.
Not for all the courses, but for probably some courses. The other ones that require practicals, you have to space the students. So if it's a big class, you divide them into two.
Mm-hmm.
One half will come, you space them well, you do the practical, then the other half will come next. So all of this had to be factored in, which was why the resumption date for universities took a while in Nigeria. It was not just the strike. It was also how COVID-19 protocol will be observed.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually it was. As I speak to you now in my university here in Futa, I can tell you for a fact that now we have chosen Zoom and we use Zoom to teach. My university had to strike a deal with Zoom, and they were able to get a good deal where the 800 lecturers here can access Zoom at any time T. So there is no maximum time.
Yeah.
For a maximum of 500 people per time.
That is good.
So that means that you can teach a large class. Mm-hmm. And if it is more than 500, we have special Zoom channels to use.
Okay.
But you are going to need access. Those mm-hmm. ones are special. So mm-hmm. for example, you want to teach a very large class like the first year, because the first year we always teach, you know,
numbers
they offer a course that take you.
Did we lose Dr. Macaulay?
Everyone, every department.
Uh-huh.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, so you are going to need access to the special Zoom channel. Mm-hmm. And so this has now made teaching online to be quite easy.
Mm-hmm.
We are also paid for data. So we were given some amounts. Yeah. For data as well by the school.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also internet on campus for the students to utilize in order to come online.
Mm-hmm.
Although it's not excellent, we are not there yet, but it's fair. So we've been able to sort it out, and all through the semester we had the last 3 months, from January to date, we mm-hmm. taught students via Zoom, and it was fine. And we had the exams and we did everything. So mm-hmm. what I'm trying to say in a nutshell is online learning has come to stay. And because of COVID, it has accelerated the process.
Absolutely.
University management are now thinking quickly what they can do to make sure that everyone comes online.
Mm-hmm.
So COVID, it's sad that COVID had to come to make us do our job. Yes, because this is something we should have done before now.
Yes.
Something we should have done before now. But all the same, COVID has accelerated the process, and it's here to stay. Now, conferences are online. People do not need to travel. A lot of training now is done online.
Mm-hmm.
And universities are now thinking critically that, do people really have to come over here?
True.
They only leave physical interaction for courses that require it. And then when they realize that for the curriculum, you do not necessarily have to travel down. They just make it an online program.
Mm-hmm.
So it's here to stay. And the world needs to adjust,
mm-hmm.
especially the people. Because I noticed that a lot of people are yet to adjust to this new normal.
Yeah. You don't want to embrace it. You know, people are always.
They are yet to embrace it. Yes. They are yet to embrace it. But it's not going. It's not going away anytime soon. As far as I'm concerned, it's here to stay. Because companies and organizations have also seen that some of their workers can actually work from home.
Yeah.
So a lot of interactions will be done online now.
Yeah.
And companies have seen that it even costs them less.
Mm-hmm.
So everyone, whether academic institution or the corporate world, I think have come to realize the importance of online learning and interaction. And it's not going to go away anytime soon.
I agree. What a way to round off. I think I like the outlook, and I think it's very pragmatic. I think it's very reasonable. You know, online has come to stay, even in the educational space or delivery, you know, so both teaching and other sectors. So, you know, the earlier we all got used to it, the better for us. And, you know, some of the infrastructural deficits which we experience in the region, some of it would have to be addressed. And the good thing is right now, it's not an optional. Before now, you'd probably be talking to stakeholders to say, we need to do this, important, and they don't see the need. Right now, it's a no-brainer. You know,
it's like they
say, you go big or you go home. So there's really no opportunity for you not to join the bandwagon. Otherwise, you know, you'll be left out. So
left behind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Babajide Macaulay, for you know, speaking with us. It's been a really wonderful conversation. And, you know, like I tell most, a lot of my guests, when I enjoy this conversation, I really know that I'll probably bring you back at some point in the near future. Really, you know, come and share more of your experience and all the amazing stuff you've been doing. So I really want to say a big thank you for, you know, joining us.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much, Ken, for having me as well. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much. And looking forward to having you again soon.
Thank you so much. And I'll be happy to definitely show up again.
Fantastic. Fantastic. So viewers, we have been speaking to Dr. Babajide Makauli, who is, a lecturer at the Federal University of Technology, Akure, in Nigeria. And, he's also the CEO of Illumenia, which is an educational consulting company. And he's talked about most of the services they offer. You know, he's also a 2012-2015 Commonwealth Scholar, an RCS 150 Fellow, as well as a Carrington Fellow. So he's just one of those Africans in the continent who are doing amazing stuff, you know, who are supporting in their own way, breaking boundaries, and sort of moving forward with the whole mantra of possibilities and achievement, which we all know Africans for. So it's been another wonderful edition with Viewpoint with Kenneth today. And I'm looking forward to speaking to you guys again next week, and where I'll feature another guest. Thank you so much, everyone, and do have a great day. Bye-bye.